87.5 K248 BR in Santa Cruz and online at kpfa.org. Please stay tuned for Pushing Limits. Keep on pushing.
Keep on pushing. I've got to keep on pushing. I can't stop now. Move up a little higher. Some way or somehow.
Happy Friday, everyone. A little slow, but we're here. It's getaway day. It's 4th of July weekend. And what's more American than sports? Welcome to Pushing Limits. I'm Sheila Gunn Cushman. And with me in studio is Mark Romoser. And
howdy.
Today we have Mark's Who's Who in Disability Sports. We have some things of Berkeley Disabled, where people actually responded some questions of ours, and then we need you. This is a call-in show today, and you can't have a call-in show without callers. Our phone numbers are 510-848-4425 and 1-800-439-5732. And so, the questions are, what do you think of sports? Sports and disability. Is that, are those two terms things that are absolutely cohesive, or are they antithetical to each other? Do you like sports? Do you hate sports? Does your disability have anything to do with those reasons or not? A little later on, hopefully, Dorian Taylor will be calling in and we'll be giving you an update. Shelley Berman did her story, constant listeners may remember, about a few months ago. She is a kayaker. Actually, and I knew I'd forget, the pronoun that they like is they. And so hopefully they will be calling in around 2:40 or 2:45 or so. And so let's start with a recorded message from Doyle Saylor. Lucretia, can you play that?
This is an email from Doyle Saylor. I'm not a sports fan. Too many things to do. I watch sports occasionally with friends, though. A famous disability issue in football is concussions that cause brain trauma. So the high pay for athletes has lured them into accepting brain trauma as a price to pay for a certain kind of athleticism. That's not so interesting from a Pushing Limits perspective. Sports often exclude disabilities. So there was a push decades ago for amateur athletes to participate in the Special Olympics, and later the Paralympics, all of which focus on concepts of excellence and winning. So they have echoes of able-bodied notions of performance. I think these areas are problematic because the larger questions of body use and disability are not actually understood in those sports. By this, I mean disability itself is a deeper question than adapting to athleticism and the rules of games tailored to various disabilities. Other animals are much more physical athletes than humans. The usual human athlete is measured by games, but everyday life matters much more than games. Rather than take games themselves too seriously, let's ask, what does disability really show us about athleticism? Athletics imply about disability that something is wrong with a person if they can't perform a certain way. Losers in games are frequently forgotten. Disability games imply that applying the winner paradigm helps people with disabilities think they can do anything, or that we can all be winners if we just find the right way to excel. So this measure is very artificial and abstracted from real life. We tend to take these measures seriously to the point of major athletes being disabled in the name of sport, whereas disability actually makes us question the meaning of things that force disability, deny disability values, dictate meaning which is entirely artificial, and in any case, not particularly useful for everyday life. People with disabilities often really want to be winners, of course, since we live in a society that is socially unequal, and poverty limits us. Yet most of us recognize the system is not built to make us realize our own specific goals. And that was from Doyle Saylor.
All righty. And we have Dorian Taylor on the phone sooner than I'd promised, but that's wonderful. Hey, Dorian, how are you?
I'm doing pretty well. How are you?
I'm doing okay. So I don't remember exactly when Shelley interviewed you, but it was, what, about 5 or 6 months ago?
No, it was actually closer to a year ago.
Oh, my God, time flies. Okay, so when we interviewed you, we talked about your story that led up to you being in kayaking, mm-hmm. and a lot of other cool stuff, your outlook on life and stuff like that. So why don't you, in, I don't know, 45 seconds, a minute, give us what's happened between now and then? Like, Germany? What happened?
Yeah, so I continued with kayaking. I continued with kayaking, and also I got the official diagnosis of a T8, incomplete paraplegia, and completed outpatient spinal cord injury rehab.
And you've been working on that for some time, right?
That's
years long process, right?
So I finally am getting proper care. So, I started focusing on sprint kayaking, and in April I went to Georgia, just outside of Gainesville, Georgia, to the Lake Lanier Olympic Park for the canoe trial to make the world championship team, and I placed fourth overall and second in my disability class with a time of like 69 seconds and some change.
Nice.
And made the USA Paracanoe World Championship team, mid-May, I competed at Duisburg, Germany, at the World Championships. And that was it was my, just to make it that far was pretty awesome. I completed the race. I didn't do all that great, but I got a chance to compete, and the experience was amazing. I just getting a chance to meet people from all over the world and kind of share. And it was a Paralympic qualifying event, so just to see people, just to see that process and witness that process and see people make that dream happen for themselves was pretty awesome as well.
So obviously you, as a person with a disability who is very into sports, have probably some opinions on that. And what would they be, I say, with a smile and some... I can totally imagine what they might be, but what will you say?
Can you repeat that? I'm sorry.
How do you feel about sports and disability? And do you think that sports affects our lives? And if so, how and all that?
Well, that's a tricky question. I don't necessarily think sports affect our lives. I think sports affect my life. I say that because as a person with a spinal cord injury who... I was using a chair for 4 years before I was even properly diagnosed or getting care. Mm-hmm. And I didn't even think I could take care of myself in any way until I started participating in sports. I left my home to be homeless to figure out what was going on with me. So sports gave me the outlet that I needed to forget about focusing on necessarily what was going wrong with my body, mm-hmm. and gave me the chance to focus on what my body could do.
Right. Okay.
So sports isn't for everybody. I don't think sports is necessarily important for everybody, but for me, it changed my life. It gave me something to focus on. It gave me something to focus my rage. And the more I began to get better and get more athletic the more I realized I could see for myself. I was able to, the stronger I got in sports, the stronger I was outside of sports, which is important.
That makes sense.
Just lifelong in general. Like, you know, I noticed I wasn't falling out of my chair as much, and it just made me feel just that boosted my self-esteem.
The confidence, yeah.
Yeah.
All righty. Well, I'm very, thank you for calling, and thank you for doing what you do and being who you are. And I appreciate you taking the time to talk with us and give us these updates. That's fabulous. I hope that next goal. So what is your next goal?
So right now I'm just taking some time to focus myself and just seeing how in conditioning and just seeing how I can sustain that kind of training, and then I'll take it from there. Hopefully I'll get it. I'll be able to continue and
alrighty.
See what I can do next time.
Alrighty. Well, all right. Thank you. I appreciate this, Dorian. I hope that we keep in touch.
Oh, great. Thank you.
All right. Take care.
Mm-hmm. Bye-bye.
So, that's a story that is ongoing, but has had a happy ending to a couple of chapters, it looks like. So, Mark, what have you got in your Who's Who box?
Yeah, it turns out that there are many people with disabilities who have performed sports at the very top major league level. So if any of you out there have kids who are disabled, it turns out, yes, they do have role models in sports. A's fans going back might very well remember Jim Abbott, who used to pitch for the Angels and later for the Yankees, who was born with one arm. Mm-hmm. What always amazed me about him was that he figured out a way to field the position. I was, why don't they just bunt it where he doesn't have an arm? But somehow he managed. The Detroit Tigers had an outfielder, Curtis Pride, who was deaf. He too later played for the Yankees, and the fans quickly figured out that plain old applause wasn't going to cut it. They had to get up and stomp on the seats.
Why?
In order to applaud for Curtis Pride, because he's deaf. He could not hear the...
Okay.
That was quite something. Every major sport has an example. Larry Brown was a running back for the Washington team in the NFL, whose name I shall not, of course, utter on KPFA's airwaves.
Okay.
And the coach, Vince Lombardi, we all associate with Green Bay, but he was coaching Washington at the time, noticed he was getting off a little slow. Turns out he had a hearing impairment, so they had to get permission from the league to build a hearing aid into his helmet.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
And he went on to, I believe, play in a Super Bowl.
All right.
On basketball, Denver had Mahmoud Abdul-Rauf, who had Tourette's syndrome, and came within one shot of being the best free throw shooter the NBA has ever seen.
And Saturday Night Live never took advantage of this?
Not to my knowledge. you would think. Then again, it's been years since I've stayed up that late.
Yeah.
And the first player of African descent in the National Hockey League, Willie O'Ree, was blind in one eye where he'd taken a puck in it.
Oh.
Of course, he had to pass. That was just like FDR did. This was quite a while ago. Mm. If the Boston Bruins had known...
Okay.
Right. If the Bruins had known that he had no vision in one eye, they would have never taken him up, but he compensated and he passed.
Yeah. All right. So, Leanne, and I'm sorry, I forgot your city. Say it again.
Orange County.
Southern Orange County, yes.
Oh, wow. We're gonna far reach today. So, what's your thought on sports?
My thought on sports is I've participated in sports since high school. I did track for 4 years and cross country for 3 years, and I did some tennis and swimming lessons. I think overall, in general, when it comes to sports, including with disabled people, it's important to have inclusivity. And mm-hmm. The problem is, it's when it comes to sports, there has been a lot of issues in regards to ableism, which is discrimination against disabled people. And
right.
Unfortunately, I've seen some discrimination back when I participated in sports in high school. And it's really disheartening to me because I'm also I'm autistic, and I've proven myself so many times. But when there's other disabled people in the team, and their disability is more even though I don't like saying it, but in this case, more visible,
right,
more noticeable, they just get a lot of bullying, and mm-hmm. it hurts me. And I think what's important is when it comes to sports in general, that we continue to be more inclusive. Look, I appreciate Special Olympics and Paralympics, but we need to realize that since the Olympics are coming, we need to be more inclusive about including disabled people in sports in general.
Yeah. Well, thank you. I agree. And I never thought that this topic would take as much fire as it has. And I'm now going, oh, my gosh, can I do everything? You're listening to KPFA. This is Pushing Limits. And today we're having a call-in show about sports and disability and their intersections and separations and such as that. And so the next person is, and Leanne, thank you for calling. I didn't say that officially, but I do appreciate it. And the next caller is Warren in San Leandro.
Hi, you guys.
Hey.
Mark and Sheila, I just wanted to say that I have a severe anxiety disorder and post-traumatic stress disorder, and what I find is sports really helps my disability. I listen to basketball and baseball. Now, I've always been a sports fan, but since I got my disabilities in 2007, I've discovered that sports really calms me down and keeps me mentally active, and listening to sports really relaxes me, and the structure of sports gives me something to look forward to during the day. I talk about it with my therapist a lot, and I just really enjoy it. It provides a daily excitement in my life, and I listen to it with my partner, so we both enjoy it.
And a bit of structure, maybe? I mean, like, you know,
absolutely.
You know when the games are, and so there's something to look forward to.
Mm-hmm. And it's a nice couples activity because I listen to it with my partner. So
right.
I really enjoy it. I've always enjoyed it, but I've discovered it really enhances my coping with my disability.
Does it calm you down, or does it give you a focus, or both, or what?
It calms me down. It keeps me mentally sharp, and it gives me a sense of structure so I don't wander into either PTSD or anxiety.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, thank you. I appreciate that.
Yeah, and Sheila was just telling me that story on the way over here. The odd thing is it works quite the opposite with me. Being autistic, I can be quite well adjusted to hanging out, and if there happens to be a ball game on and the Dodgers get an infield single with nobody on and two out in a 5-run game, I'll get all anxious. How could you do that, you worthless bum?
Bleep, 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 bleep. Yeah. You start bleeping like a Morse code if you keep that up. Yeah, I get it. Okay, well, we could go a couple different ways. We could do more Who's Who, or we've got a couple more. Why don't we play Bob from Berkeley Disabled List?
That email was from Bob.
Whoops. Let's try that again.
This is an email from Bob. I ski, canoe, and fly a hand-controlled glider with Freedom's wings. Occasionally do some other sports, but it is the equality when I'm skiing or canoeing, and especially flying, that is so refreshing. When I'm in the glider, it doesn't care how I fly it or how I get around on the earth. Beyond competitive sports, recreational sports are fun for everyone. I fly, and that aircraft doesn't know I'm disabled and using hand controls. The laws of physics don't change for me. It's a great equalizer. From the outside, my aircraft resembles all the others of the same make and model. Same with skiing. Gravity works on all of us the same. Develop the skills and use them to work with gravity. Getting into my canoe, ski, or aircraft is an equalizer. We're all the same. Wheelchairs don't matter. P.S. I'm not rich. I belong to a club of pilots with disabilities. That email was from Bob.
Oh, there I am. All right. So I had a thought just went out of my head. This happens to everybody. I think that it's interesting how the range is about how different people look at sports differently. And we got an email this morning that we didn't get a chance to record, but I'll basically paraphrase. It was from Alicia, and she said that she's into quad rugby, which I'd never even heard of, and I got this like an hour before I got on the road. I didn't have time to research it. Mark, you know about a movie about that. What is it?
A movie was made about quad rugby called Murder Ball. I mean, in quad rugby, you're basically pushing a ball around the court with a power chair. There are frequent collisions between power chairs, hence Murder Ball.
Uh-huh. And is this, but is this isn't a Hollywood movie? It must probably be a
probably an indie thing. But it,
yeah. So, but these power chairs aren't designed for such. How do they? They must have to do a lot of repairs.
I do know that in power soccer there are special chairs and special attachments that players get for their chair. This is a different, less violent sport in which the object, as in soccer, is to maneuver the ball into a goal.
Mm-hmm.
Very popular here in the Bay Area.
Yeah. I don't know if Adrienne has done this, and by the way, I need to thank Adrienne for these recordings. They were fabulous. And Shelley and the whole Pushing Limits gang, really. She may have already, and if she doesn't have it yet, she will probably soon have stuff up on the website about sports. And what I hope is that we'll also put up the comments that we've gotten in case we don't get to play them all, that we've received about this. This could be a longer conversation, and we've heard about inclusivity. We've heard about that ableism does affect how we think of sports, how we play sports. Some of us maybe feel more able when we play sports, and our confidence goes up. But my relationship with sports is that when I was a kid, my grandpa always had every game on, didn't matter what kind. And I got frustrated because when the games were on, we couldn't do anything else. So I didn't like sports then. And then later, I had a love who, and still have that love, but anyway, I had a love who loved sports, and I got into sports a lot, and I'm a baseball fan and somewhat of a basketball fan. You can't help but be a basketball fan in the Bay Area, although, yes, it's awful. Anyway, we'll get it next year. but we have, I enjoy baseball now, and I enjoy sports now, and it's interesting how many sports terms have come into our vocabulary as a culture. Even those who aren't into sports use these terms. It's interesting. We probably have time for a couple more calls if you're quick. 510-848-4425 and 800-439-5732. Mark, why don't you throw more who's at us?
Okay, before we leave, it's important to mention the case of golfer Casey Martin, who played college golf for Stanford.
Yeah?
He has a mobility disability. He has no circulation in one leg.
Okay.
So when he turned pro, he figured he'd continue to use a golf cart as a reasonable accommodation.
Mm-hmm.
The golf establishment, it fought him tooth and nail that would somehow disrupt the purity of the game if he was able to use a golf cart while everyone else had to lug their bags in the hot sun down all the fairways.
Mm.
He took it all the way to the Supreme Court and won, but by that time he had used up so much energy fighting the golf establishment in court that he didn't have much left on the course. I'm sorry. Then this is the same establishment that, for years resisted admitting African Americans, other minorities, and women into their private clubs, you see. So that's
Yeah, it never ends. These people don't learn. Okay, Christina from Petaluma, you're on.
Hi. I know there's not a lot of time left, but I was wondering if we could link sports and maybe somehow, you know, include the disability community. I'm semi-disabled with a head injury,
mm-hmm.
and I just finished picking up some trash along a railroad track in Petaluma, and you know, sports has really taken over the lives of a lot of people, not just the male race, but and I love sports myself, and but I've been pretty too disabled really to participate much anymore
mm-hmm.
for the past 10 years or so. But simple things like, you know, environmental stewardship, and I was wondering if we could create a green scorecard. make it a literal sport, a competition. Because everywhere these events are held, whether it's a swimming place or a golf course or a stadium, there's always some land around that vicinity that could be stewarded, you know?
So what you're talking about is, so there's three things I'm hearing, but I can't follow it. One is sports, and one is disability, and one is environmentalism. And you're saying, are you saying that sport...
Yeah.
Are you saying that the stadiums need to be more environmentally conscious and friendly, or?
I think actually the sports players themselves, you know, it's like any celebrity who comes to the aid of an action for a cause, and so since climate change is so important right now, and a lot of these events take place, and a huge number of people travel to them, and then there's huge parking lots that, you know, put off all this heat,
right.
And it all combines to make, you know, a large footprint. So we should offset that footprint with another sport.
Right.
Even if it was just in a state, from county to county, you know,
so,
a game where we play frisbee golf, but on the golf disc you have the squirrel or you have whatever creatures live in that environment.
So you're saying that there needs to be endorsement by sports of environmental issues.
Yeah. And make it fun, so you have a green scorecard, you know, you make it competitive.
And contests and all that.
Competitive, because Americans love competition, and disabled people can get in on it in any way in terms of helping it. And I don't know, if I had some website, I want to start one called The Buck Stops Here.
Well, all right. I'm gonna bounce off, but thank you. Yeah, we need to think about stuff like that. It's not... sports persons have our ear, and we must take advantage of that. All right. I want to thank Lucretia, our wonderful engineer, who's been holding down the tiller back there, and thanks to Mark Romoser and the whole Pushing Limits crew. We'll be back on July 15th. Stay safe and sane this weekend, everybody. Don't forget to breathe.
Occidental Center for the Arts presents the Alive Reunion Concert on Saturday, July 16th at 8 p.m. This iconic all-women's jazz quintet is celebrating its 40th year with a reunion tour featuring original members. Experience the spiritual power, infectious rhythms, stunning vocals, and intelligent, heartfelt compositions that made Alive so unique and formative in women's music and the international jazz scene. Reservations advised. Find refreshments for sale. Wheelchair accessible. This is a benefit for Occidental Center for the Arts, a nonprofit performing and fine arts center located at 3850 Doris Murphy Court in Harmony Village, Occidental. www.occidentalcenterforthearts.org 707-874-9392.
In
is now 3 o'clock here at KPFA 94.1 FM in Berkeley, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, and online at